Welcome to the lecture on scope and lifetime of variables in C. So we start the discussion with what are called automatic or local variables. So the purpose of this example program is to understand when variables are created during the execution of a program and when the created variables are getting killed. So in this single main function, two variables are created with the same name and the same data type. Is it possible? Okay, we can see how the execution progresses. So if you start executing the main function, it comes to the first executable statement where it prints the value of this variable. Now the value is capital M and that is getting printed. And now before proceeding to the next statement, so there is a new block defined here without a control statement E for any loop, just a pair of braces is provided. And that is valid in C, which is a block structured language. And in a block structured language, each block or a compound statement like this is allowed to define variables just like a function. So just like the main function, any block can define variables. So if you execute this function, you can see that, so what will happen, right? So declaration of a variable like this with the same name of this variable is allowed, and this definition is set to override this definition. That means within this block, the new definition will apply. So if you print here, the value printed will be B. And it comes to the last statement. And it is interesting to see what value of A will be printed. Is it B or M? If you print, you can see that the value printed is M. And why is? Because the scope or accessibility of a variable which is defined like this starts from the point of definition of the variable and goes till the last statement of the block in which the variable is defined. So the blue variable A is accessible in this block and the red A is accessible in the red block. And so this statement is in the red block. So what is printed is the value of this variable. Okay, so what is important is the scope, which is the portion of the program where a variable is accessible. And all the variables, including the formal arguments, which are defined within a function are called automatic or local variables unless otherwise specified. And later we will see how other kind of a variable can be defined within a function. Okay, for the time being, anything which is defined, any variable which is defined within a function, even including formal arguments if any, are said to be automatic or local variables, and their access starts from the point of definition and goes till the last statement of the block in which it is defined. Here is a slight variation in the example where I have just removed the curly braces, and then the question is, then can I have a variable with the same name? Okay, now I have two definitions for the variable A, within the same block. Is that possible? If you try to execute it, the C compiler will tell you it is not possible. It will give you an error message, redefinition of A. That means within a same block, only one definition is possible for a variable. And if you start a new block here, you can have this. Okay. So this is the single block. So this definition is not allowed. So now we can try to recollect what we studied about local or automatic variables. All variables and formal arguments defined within a function definition are called automatic or local variables. And what is the lifetime of local variables? Lifetime means when a variable gets memory allocation and how long the memory allocation stands valid, and that is the lifetime. That is the time through which the memory allocation stands valid. And if you try to picturize the time of execution of a program, and here this line shows the execution of your functioning of your computer. Okay, not your program, it's a computer system clock. When your computer is booted or switched on, it started with the time zero and it progresses all the way to the right until you switch it off. Okay, now suppose you execute a C program. It is getting started at time M and entered at time N. When you say starting the execution of the program, you know that the main function is started. And now suppose you execute another function, say foo. So main started at this point, and after this time elapse, at time point I, you make a call to the function foo. So foo is getting executed, and finally suppose foo terminates at time point j, and after that the main continues, and finally main also finishes, and when main finishes, the program ends. Okay, and we are interested in knowing what is the lifetime of a variable which is declared inside foo. The lifetime is throughout the execution of the instance of the function. That is, the lifetime also starts at this point itself and ends at this point. So the lifetime of a variable declared within a function coincides with the lifetime of the function itself. Okay, now we can see another aspect of a variable, which is the scope or accessibility. That tells you the portion of your program in which a variable is accessible. If you try to picturize, you can see that a variable which is declared like this is accessible in this portion, because this is getting defined in this block. So this is the portion where this variable is accessible. Okay, this is what is called the scope of the variable. That is, in which all statements you can make use of the variable A, which is called the scope. Okay, and the relationship between the lifetime is that in this example, the main function starts here and ends here. Main makes a call to foo, it starts here and ends here. And the lifetime of A starts with the foo and ends with the foo. The lifetime is throughout the execution of foo, and its accessibility starts at this point, which is marked as P. Okay, P is the time at which this statement is executed, the statement after this. And Q is the time at which the last statement finishes its execution. That is what this time point is representing. Okay, I think with this example, the relationship between the lifetime and the scope is clear to you. The lifetime is the point in the points, the consecutive time points where the variable has life, or when the memory is allocated and when the memory is taken back. Okay, and the scope is accessibility, and the accessibility is within this period, and it starts with the point of definition in the program and ends with the point of definition in the program. So the lifetime starts with this point itself and ends with this point. Accessibility starts at this point and ends at this point. And if you declare A here, and then suppose there was another variable A declared here, then within this block, this A is what is accessible. This is not accessible, and that's what I mean by this point. And explicit initialization is declared for an automatic variable. That means if you are not declaring this variable, then at this point, the variable, the value of the variable A is unknown. Okay, so explicit initialization is required for a local or automatic variable. Then storage class, we can see what is a storage class, and this is actually the storage class. To be complete, the declaration of a variable should start with the specification of the storage class. This is automatic variable, and the storage class is auto. And remember, we have never used it, because by default, any variables storage class specifier is taken as automatic. Okay, so even if you are not specifying auto in front of this, it is actually equivalent to this. So all the variables which are defined within a function are automatically taken as having the storage class. This is what is called the storage class auto. And the storage class defines the lifetime and scope of a variable. And the default storage class for variables which are defined within a function is auto, to define automatic variables. So with that, we are finishing the discussion on automatic or local variables, which are variables defined within a function, and their lifetime starts with the execution of that function and ends with the execution of the function. And their scope is the sequence of statements in the block in which the variable is defined, and it starts with the declaration statement. Now we can move on to the next section, where we study what are called external or global variables. The purpose of this example is to study the use of external variables. And here, see, there are two functions in this example, main function and foo. And a variable C is declared outside of these two functions. Until now, we have not seen such a declaration which is outside the definitions of all the functions in the program. And the variables which are declared like this are called global variables or external variables, because which are defined externally, not inside any function. And we can understand what it is by considering how the execution progresses. So when the program starts execution, just before the main function is executed, global variable is getting memory allocated. Here there is a single global variable C, and which is initialized to the constant capital G. So the lifetime starts with the execution of the program, unlike automatic variable, which are created when that concerned function is executed. Global variables are allocated memory at the beginning of the execution of the program. And let us see how the execution progresses. It comes to this first statement, and which is a function call, so it just goes to foo and it comes to the first executable statement. And it tries to print the value of C. C is a variable which is a global variable. Okay, is that accessible here? Yes, accessible. The definition of a global variable extends to all functions which are defined after the definition of the global variable. Or in other words, the scope of a global variable extends from the point of definition to all the functions which are defined after the definition of the global variable. So it is accessible to both foo and main. So if you print, you will get the value as the current value, which is G. And now it comes to this statement where it is trying to reassign E to C. So if you execute, C is the global variable value is changed to E. And last statement is finished, so it returns to main and it progresses to the next statement where it tries to print the value of C again. So what value will be printed? Yes, E will be printed. And why is it E? Because the changes made to external variables by a function gets reflected in all other functions where the global variable is accessible. That means if you change the value of C inside foo, that change is reflected in main as well, because C is a global variable. So the change is reflected in all the functions in the scope of the global variable. And now, because of the definition of C here, a new local variable is declared with the same name of the global variable. So after this, only the local variable will be accessible, because this definition is getting overridden with this definition that we have already discussed in automatic variable. So when it comes to the last statement, what will be printed is M. Okay, so what we studied is that global variables are those variables which are defined outside the definitions of all the functions in a program. And the lifetime starts with the, yes, beginning of the program execution and ends with the end of the program execution. And the scope extends to all functions which are defined after the definition of the global variable. So let us recollect what we did. And if you try to draw the timeline, then the lifetime of global variables starts with the lifetime of the program and ends with the lifetime of the program. And if you want to see the accessibility, then you consider an example program like this, where a global variable GA is defined, but which is getting defined after the main function definition. So it is accessible to all the functions which are defined after this. This is the accessible area. Okay. So global variable is accessible to all functions which are defined after the definition of the global variable. So if you try to relate it with the timeline, the lifetime of global variable starts with the program and ends with the program, and the accessibility is here. That means this point. This point is marked as P here. Okay, it is starting with the definition and going to the last statement of the program. And in this case also, if you override, that means just like this, if you override, then this value, this variable definition is overrided by this definition, or only this definition is accessible afterwards. in that function. Okay, so that's what this point is meaning. And unlike automatic variables, external variables have a default initialization value, which is zero. That is, even if you are not declaring it, the system will initialize it as zero. So for all numeric value, zero is the initial value. And if it's a character variable, it is the character represented by the numeric value zero. Now the purpose is to discuss an application of a global variable. And here in this example, I have this global variable A and variables A and B defined. And what I'm doing is I'm assigning values from main and I'm printing the values. And after that, I'm interchanging the values without passing arguments and returning values. Okay. And this is possible because I am using global variables. As I said, when the program starts its execution, the global variables are allocated and it's getting the default initialization values zero. And it comes to this statement, then the values are changed to 10 and 20 respectively. And then I print the values. Okay, 10 and 20. And then I make a call to the function interchange. What this function is doing is just interchanging the values of A and B. So the values of A and B are interchanged and it just returns the control. See that there is no explicit return, just control is returned. And it comes to the last statement, and if I print the values, I will get 20 and 10. So global variables, if you change the values within a function, the change is reflected in another function also if the scope is there. So global variables enable sharing of data among various functions in a program. Okay, you can have a global array. If you declare a global array, then there is no need to pass an array as an argument to a function. Okay, but it will be accessible in all the functions which are defined after the array definition. So you must be careful to not make unintended changes to a global data. Okay, so global variables can be used to share data among various functions in a program. Okay, then what is the storage class for global variables? We saw that the storage class for automatic variables are auto. And here, what is the storage class? If you remember, we have not used any storage class for A and B. And in C, actually, the storage class specifier is not required to define global variables. In fact, certain C compiler don't allow you to specify the storage class in variable definition. But in this case, if you look at, it's the same program to interchange, but I moved the definition of A and B here. So I am defining it just before main, so the accessibility is confined to main only. But I wanted to use it in this function also. So one way is you move this definition to this point. Another way is you provide a declaration of an external variable. So in that case, the storage specifier, which is extern is the storage specifier, which is a must, and which is used to declare a global variable, which is defined somewhere else. So for global variables, declaration and definition are different. Definition means you are creating variables. That is, definition requires the system to allocate memory, while declaration is not creating any variable, but it just extends its accessibility to the function where the variable is declared. Okay, so for global variables, declaration and definition are different, and these are the only kind of variables in C for which definition and declaration are different. For all other kinds of variables like automatic or static and register variables that we study after this, for all the other three kinds, declaration and definition are same, but for global variables or external variables, declaration and definition are different. Here are some more points about external or global variables. If you want, you can initialize an external variable. You know that the default initialization is 0, and if you want to initialize some other value, you can do it. But in that case, you have to assign a constant value as a initial value. And you know that declaration is not creating any variable. It is just extending the scope, and hence in declaration, you cannot have initialization. For example, here you cannot say that A or B is equal to 0 or any other value, because it's not a definition. It just says that I want to extend the scope of these variables which are defined somewhere else to this function. So declaration is different, and in declaration initialization is not possible. And being finished the discussion on global variables, here there is a common advice to you to see where is the ideal position to define user-defined data type. If you recall, we studied about structures and unions and other user-defined data types, and where is the ideal position in your program to specify or define user-defined data types. And here is the common advice. It is between the preprocessor directives and definition of global variables. So the structure, the general advice is this: the structure of your program looks like this. First, the preprocessor directives, that is starting with hash, and then the specification of the user-defined data types, and after user-defined data types, definition of global variables, and then the rest of the program. This is only an advice that you can decide where you want to do it. But if you specify user-defined data types like this, then you can declare variables of these data types in any functions which are getting defined after this. Okay, this is only a request or general advice, but the programmer can decide when he wants to or where he wants to include the specification of the user-defined data types. So far in this class, we discussed about automatic variables and global variables, and now we are moving on to static variables in C. And what are static variables? We start with a motivating example, and here there is a program, and what main is doing is it first reads a number. Say you are giving an input number, and for that many times in a loop, what the program is doing is it reads in every pass of the loop, it reads three numbers, and depending on the value of C, it makes a call to foo. Okay, if the value of C is in between 10 and 20, it makes a call to foo, and after that it just makes a call to bar, and within the function bar, it's again making a call to foo if this condition is true. Okay, so it reads a number, and that many times what it do is it reads three numbers, depending on the value of C, it may call foo, and after that bar is being called within the loop, and bar is making a call to foo if a condition is met. And we have to find the number of times the function foo is executed. That is, here you want to include a printf statement to print how many times the function foo is called. Okay, so it's impossible to manually look at this code and say how many times, because it is a factor of the number of numbers that, sorry, the number that you give to n, and also it depends on the values of a, b and c. Okay, so maybe if you are given with all input you can find it, but here the question is to write this program in such a manner that when the program finishes, it should print the number of times the function foo is invoked. So how will you do that? So can you do it like this? Can you have a count, a number variable count here, which gets incremented whenever this function is called, like this? So I'm just declaring a unsigned variable count which is initialized to 0 and is incremented whenever this function is called, and assume that here I'm just returning the count. Okay, this is returning the count. Is that enough? No, that's not enough, because it's not going to be useful, since this is an automatic variable. You know that without any storage specifier, inside a function is automatic variable. And the lifetime starts with the execution of the function and ends with the execution of the function. So when foo is called from here, a new variable count is created, it increments to 1, and then it returns that 1, and that variable has gone. Next time when foo is called, maybe from here, a new variable count is created and is incremented, and that incremented value 1 is again returned. So regardless of the number of times it is called, every time this initialization happens, and hence you will only get the return value as 1. And that is the property of an automatic variable whose lifetime is only within the lifetime of the function instance. So when you call foo from here, an instance of foo is created. When that foo returns, the instance is deleted and the count variable is also is not existing after that instance. So what we need really is a special kind of a variable which can retain its value across different execution. That means even after the function foo returns, the count should retain its previous value. That means if you do that, the initialization should happen only once. The first time when it is executed, maybe the initialization can be performed, and the next time this initialization statement should not be executed. Okay, and this is possible in C with what are called static variables. A static variable is a variable whose initialization is performed only once, and that variable so lifetime is throughout the execution of the program, and the variable can retain its previous value when the next execution starts. Okay, so if you do this, where the only change I made is I have specified the storage class as static. Okay, when you specify it as static, the initialization happens only once, and the value of count is retained across various instances or executions of the function foo. So what I do here is I'm just printing the value after this loop. Okay, and how can I print? I just make an additional call to foo, so I will get this count returned and I'm printing it. Because of this additional call, I'm subtracting 1. So if you execute this program and see, I have executed this program, I have given 3 as input, So this loop will execute for 3 times. So initially I am inputting the values 10, 8 and 12. Now because C is 12, this condition is satisfied and foo is called. So the count is 1. And after that bar is called 10 and 8. 10 is greater than 8. So again foo is called. So the count is 2. Okay, this foo call and this foo call 2. And after it the loop goes again. So next 3 values are 10, 20 and 20. 20 is not in between these two, not less than 20. So this call is not happening, but bar is happening. And 10 is not greater than 20. So this call is again not possible. So for this input, no call to foo. From this input, 2 calls were there. Here, no calls. And for the next input, it is 18. Because of 18, this call happens. So 3 plus 1, 4. Then bar happens. 120 is greater than 38. So this foo again happens. So 3 plus 1, 4 calls are there. And the 4 is getting printed. Okay. And offline, you can look at this example if you want to, or if you are not getting all about this program. But the only thing that is take home from this example is that when you specify a variable as static, then it can retain its value across various executions. And it will be clear when we recollect what we studied using that example. Variables which are declared in a function by explicitly specifying the storage class as static are called static variables. So we know that if storage class specifier is not there within a function, then a variable is automatic. And if storage class specifier is explicitly made as static, the variable is declared as having the storage class static. And they can retain their values across various executions. And things will be clear only when you discuss about the lifetime and scope of static variables. The lifetime is throughout the execution of the program. That means if you draw the timeline, here in this timeline, the computer starts functioning at this point and it goes like this forever. And at time point M, the program is starting its execution. Okay. So program means the execution of the main function. And after a time elapse, at time point I, the function foo is called. And within foo, assume that there is a static variable called count. And even if the lifetime of foo starts only at point I, the lifetime of the static variable of foo starts with the lifetime of the main itself. Okay, and that is the main difference. Even if you declare a static variable within a function, before that function is executed, the variables are allocated memory. For all static variables, the memory is allocated just before calling the main function. Okay, so the variables are allocated at the beginning of the program and the allocation stands valid till the end of the program, and that is this yellow bar shows. So even if you create a static variable or declare a static variable within the function foo, its lifetime starts with the program and go till the end of the program. So the lifetime is throughout the execution of the program. Not only that, the initialization also is happening at the beginning of the program. That means if you look at this example, even though you specify the initialization here, the initialization happens just before executing the main function itself. Okay, it is just like you have done it before here. Okay, So, and that is why the initialization is performed only once. So, this is a very important point. The initialization to static variables happens at the beginning of the program, regardless of in which function that static variable is declared. Okay. And next, the scope or accessibility of static variables. The accessibility of a static variable is just like an automatic variable, no difference. Okay, the accessibility or the portion of the program where it is accessible is same as that of a local variable. It starts with the point of definition and goes till the last statement of the block where the variable is declared. Okay, so the lifetime is same as that of global variables. And scope is same as that of automatic variables. And if you redefine, that means suppose you have a count declared here, then this declaration is overridden by this definition. That means within this block, this definition will be valid. And default initialization is zero, just like global variables. The lifetime is same as global variables and initialization is also same as that of global variables. So, the default initialization value is zero. So, with that, I am giving you an exercise using static variables. So, I am giving you a part of the program and you just have to fill this part of the program. And what I am doing is, I am reading a number and I am printing, I am trying to print the first n Fibonacci numbers, okay. And the first two Fibonacci numbers are directly printed here. And from 2 onwards, I am making a call to Fibonacci without passing any argument. So, the Fibonacci should give me back the ith Fibonacci number starting from 2, okay. So, what you are asked to do is complete the definition of the function Fibonacci. Just 5 lines are enough to give the following output when I give the input as 12, the first 12 Fibonacci numbers. And not that the 0 and 1 are directly printed here, and you have to print the Fibonacci number from this position onwards. This is the 0th position, this is the first position. And from second position till the 12th position or nth position, you have to find the Fibonacci number and then you have to print it. And try to use static variables to implement this. And you can see that without static variables, it is impossible because no argument is passed to it. And by using this as an illustrative example, you explain the use of static variables. And with that, we are finishing the discussion on static variables. So, till now, we have discussed about automatic variables, global variables, and static variables. Okay, with this, we are moving on to the section where we can see the different memory segments that a C program is getting when it is executed. So, these are the different memory segments that a C program is maintaining when it is executing. So, there is a code segment where the program code is stored, and there is another segment where all the global and static variables are stored. Okay. We know that both global and static variables are having the same lifetime, and that is throughout the execution of the entire program. And for these two kinds of variables, there is a separate pool of memory. And after that, there is a stack storage. And if you recall, we have discussed about stack when we discussed about functions in C and recursive functions, calls, etc. And it's very important to see what are the components of the stack but the details is beyond the scope of this course. Maybe we can look at it very abstractly. These are the various parts of a stack frame. For each function, it is getting a stack frame, and it contains the callee save registers. So initially, it contains parameters. If you call a function foo, all the parameters are copied into the stack. Then the return address of the function, if main is calling foo, then to which statement in main I have to return, and that part is also contained in the stack. And maybe main is the only function which is existing when you call foo, and there is a stack frame for main also. This is the pointer to the stack frame. Then memory for all the local variables, automatic variables are created in the stack. And buffer is used to store temporary results during the execution of a function. And if that function foo is in turn calling bar, then the microprocessor registers maybe having temporary values. To store it, there is another storage area. Anyway, this is out of scope when this course is concerned. So you don't have to worry about all this. You just say that this is where the local variables are stored. And there is another storage which is for managing the memory, which is allocated using dynamic memory allocation. And that also is out of scope. Okay, so the take home from this slide is that there are various memory segments. One to store the program code, then to store the values of global and stack static variables, and another block to store the values of local or automatic variables. Okay. With that, we are moving on to the last storage class, which is register variables. And we can try to understand what are register variables with this simple example. Here, I declare three integer variables with the storage class as registered. And what it tells is, it specifies that CPU registers may be allocated to the variables if possible. That is, rather than allocating main memory to A, B, and C, store the values of A, B, and C in CPU registers itself. And if the values are stored in registers, then the execution becomes faster, because no need to fetch data from the memory. You can directly execute within the CPU itself. And if you are declaring variables as register variables, the value is stored in registers, and hence the address operator is not allowed. So ampersand A is for storing. Sorry, this is not allowed. This is a mistake. And ampersand operators are not allowed. Okay, and this is the typo. And register allocation is subjective depending on the system. If the system can allocate register, and if the registers are available, then the variables will be stored in registers. Otherwise, these will be treated as automatic variables. Okay. And the lifetime and scope are same as that of automatic variables. Okay, so the register variables are just like automatic variables as far as the lifetime and scope are concerned. But registers may be allocated for the register variables. In that case, execution becomes faster. So the only case in which a programmer needs to get register variable is to minimize the execution time of the function. Otherwise, these are just like automatic variables. And with this, we are finishing the discussion on different storage classes. And today, we have discussed about automatic variables, global variables, static variables, and register variables. And automatic and register variables are having the same scope and lifetime, which is just the lifetime of the function in which it is that variables are declared. But the only difference between automatic and register variables is that register variables, if they are getting registers to store data, then the execution becomes faster. And static variables have the same lifetime as global variables, which is throughout the execution of the entire program, and the scope of a static variable is same as that of an automatic variable. And that's what we discussed today. With this, we are moving on to the last part of this lecture, which is a discussion about bitwise operators in C. C provides some low level operations, which is operation at the level of binary bits on numeric values. And the purpose of this section is to study the basic bitwise operators permitted in C. We can start with the bitwise complement operation, and I am trying to explain each operator with an example, illustrative example. So here what I am doing is, I am assigning a hexadecimal value to a short integer a, and I am trying to print its complement, and complement operator is this. So I am trying to print its complement, and if you execute, you will get this value. Okay, how you are getting it? So actually what I am printing is the complement of this hexadecimal value, which expands to this binary value. You know that each hexadecimal digit is represented by 4 binary digits. This is nothing but an expansion of the hexadecimal value into binary. So 8 is 1000, F is 1111. And the complement, you know that, is just flipping the status of 0 and 1. All zeros becomes 1 and all 1s becomes 0. So this is 7 and all these are F and this is 0. So the value is 7, then 6F, 0, and that is what you are getting as output. Okay, it's very easy. It's just the complement, the binary complement. And the next operator is bitwise OR, and here is the example. And this is the OR operator, this pipe character, okay. And two pipe characters is logical OR, and this is the bitwise OR. And if you execute, you will get this value printed. You can see why. If you expand the value of A and B, it is this. Okay, sorry, this should be 1. Sorry for the mistake, this is 1. Okay, because 8 is 1000. Okay, you have to read this as 1. Okay, so OR means if any one bit is 1, then the result is 1. So 1 or 0 is 1, 1 or 0 is 1, and likewise it goes. In all the positions you are getting 1, and so the result is all F. Okay, so this is bitwise OR. It's very simple, and it is doing a bitwise operator. Each bits at each position is operated on. Okay, and that is the bitwise OR, and with this we are moving on to the next bitwise operator, which is AND operator. Consider this example, and this is the AND operator. Single AND is the bitwise AND, and if you execute, you will get this output. And why? Because you are doing these two, and then if you do that, and this is the expanded binary values. 8 is 1000, 0 is 4 zeros, F is 4 ones, 4 is 0100. Likewise, it gets expanded. That means it's the bitwise AND. Okay, 1 and 1 is 1, and 0 and 0 is 0, 1 and 0 is 0, 1 and 1 is 1. So likewise, you are getting the value. So it's 0, 0, F, 0, 0, 0, 0, F, and that is what you are getting. Okay, that is the bitwise AND. And now with this, we are moving on to the next logical bitwise operator, which is the exclusive OR. So very similar, the operator is this caret, and if you execute, you will get this output, because if you see the expansion of the operands, it is this, it is the bitwise exclusive OR, and the exclusive OR value is 1, the operands are of different values. 1 and 1 exclusive OR 1 is 0, 0 exclusive OR 0 is 0, but 0 exclusive OR 1 is 1, and 1 exclusive OR 0 is 1. So it's just the exclusive OR. What you want to remember is only the operator. Okay. With this, we are moving on to the bitwise shift operations. First one is the right shift. And right shift operator is this. Okay. Greater than, two greater than symbols means the right shift. Here I want to right shift the value of A two positions to the right. Okay, so I am getting this value. Why is because this operand is expanded to this binary value. So I want to do right shift to two positions. So when I do this, the rightmost two bits are going out, and to the left, two new bits are coming, that is zero. Okay, so right shift means you do a right shift in this string. So when you do right shift, the rightmost values are going out, and so you have to get two new values in the leftmost position, and new values are zeros. Okay, and so this is the thing, it's just the right shift, you can just see it offline, and the value is, this is 3 and all these are zeros, and this is 3, and that is why you get this value. Okay, this is the bitwise right shift. And the last bitwise operator we are discussing is bitwise left shift. It's just the opposite. And this is the operator. And if you operate on, you will get this value. See why is it so. So you want to shift this value to the left two positions. And this is the expanded value. And so if you, and this any number you can give, I am giving it as 2. Two positions to the left. So these two zeros will go out, and from here one left, two left shifts happen. So what happens is two new zeros are coming to these two positions. So these two ones comes here, these two ones comes here, and these new zeros comes in these positions. So that is what this is. So from the leftmost position, two values, whatever be the values here, they are going out. And then the whole string is shifted two positions to the left. So till here you are getting values. Okay, and so you see that these two ones are coming here. These two ones are coming here. And new bits you are getting are zeros. And what is the value? This is 1100, which is C, and this is 1100 C, and this is 0011, which is 3, and that is why the value is C000003C. Maybe offline you can look at what exactly these bitwise operators are. With this, we are finishing this lecture. And with this lecture, we are finishing the Programming in C course, and wish you all the success for your examination and for your professional future. I hope that our course has helped you to learn the basics of Programming in C. I'm looking forward to see the solutions for all the exercise problems given in this lecture and in all the previous lectures. And with that, we are stopping, and thank you for attending my course, and wish you all the very best. Thank you.